Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the University of Kentucky, and if you're streaming online, thank you so much for joining us. My name is William Duvall, and I'm the chapter president for the Young Americans Foundation here at the University of Kentucky. We meet every Monday at 7 p.m. in Whitehall, room 209, if you're ever interested in joining one of our meetings. Or you can find us on BB Involved and reach out that way. This event welcomes opposing views and questions. That said, any disruptions during the speaker's remarks will not be tolerated. A disruption could be, but is not limited to, standing, blocking the view of others, shouting, making derogatory remarks, or using obscenities. If you are considered to be in violation of any of these, on-site staff will ask you to stop. If you refuse to comply, UKPD will have you escorted off the premises. Questions will be permitted in the Q&A session at the end of the lecture. During the Q&A session, please follow the instructions of our YAF volunteers to get in line and ask your question. On behalf of our chapter, we would like to thank everyone who has helped to make this event possible. We would especially like to thank our faculty advisor, Dr. Ferrier, the UK Event Office, UKPD, Gianna Malaro, Patrick Hoyle, and of course, Young Americas Foundation. We would also like to give a special thanks to our generous sponsor of the T.W. Lewis Advancing Traditional Lectures lecture series. Without his support, none of this would have been possible, Mr. T.W. Lewis. Our guest tonight spoke at the University of Kentucky 3 years ago when he presented Men Are Not Women and Other Uncomfortable Truths. He's the author of the best-selling books Reasons to Vote for Democrats, A Comprehensive Guide, and Speechless, Controlling Words, Controlling Minds. He is the host of the book club at PragerU, Verdict with Ted Cruz, and the Michael Knowles Show on the Daily Wire. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please join me in welcoming Michael Knowles.
Wow, this is great. Wow, thank you so much. It is great, great to be with you. Always a pleasure to be in Kentucky. I'm looking forward to lots and lots of bourbon after tonight's event. I was strongly considering sampling the local fare when I first arrived here today, but I decided it would be better not to give this speech in cursive tonight, so I'm going to wait. I want to thank the students here at the University of Kentucky for the invitation. Thank you to YAF, as always, for hosting. And thank you to the T.W. Lewis Foundation for sponsoring this event. I'm very grateful to all of you, and so I will hold off on the bourbon until just after the speech. The other reason why it would probably have been a bad idea to show up hammered for tonight's event is that it would have given the libs yet another excuse to write off everything that we say as crazy. They're going to do that anyway. That's what they always do when conservatives cite facts and make sound, logical arguments. They do that because they have no logical arguments of their own. So when they're not calling us racists and fascists and terrorists, they're calling us nuts and kooks and conspiracy theorists. Now that last one, that is my favorite one because it is so incredibly effective. It doesn't mean anything, but it's very, very effective. After racist, conspiracy theorist is probably the single worst thing that you can be called in our society. The minute that you get labeled a conspiracy theorist, pretty much everything that you have to say ceases to be taken seriously. By the left, certainly, but even by many in the center and on the right. Yet, easy as it is to destroy someone with accusations of conspiracy theorism, the same as with accusations of racism, it is much easier to ruin someone by calling him a conspiracy theorist than it is to define precisely what a conspiracy theory is. A number of conspiracy theories have cropped up in recent years, particularly regarding COVID. Maybe you've heard of some of them. For instance, in the early days of COVID, there was a conspiracy theory that COVID most likely originated at a Chinese laboratory and not in nature or in a bad bowl of bat soup. Now, all of the established scientific and political authorities, Dr. Fauci, Rochelle Walensky, the CDC director, Joe Biden, all of them, the entire establishment media, they all denounced this theory as crazy, absurd, scientifically impossible. Then, after a year and a half of denouncing it, when the evidence in support of the theory became undeniable, they quietly admitted that it was true.
Now, once the authorities admitted that the virus most likely came from the Chinese lab, another conspiracy theory cropped up. The theory that the United States had actually funded the sort of research associated with viruses like COVID-19 at the very laboratory where the virus originated. This conspiracy theory, this was outrageous. Not only did the serious, credible, scientific authorities in all the very fancy lab coats denounce this theory, but Dr. Fauci himself denied it under penalty of perjury before the U.S. Senate. Now, of course, that was before a Freedom of Information Act request produced the receipts showing that the United States had, in fact, funded the risky research on bat coronaviruses with specific subgrants for the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And guess who signed off on the funding? You'll never guess. No, you will guess. It was Dr. Fauci. It's amazing. That he's so smart. He's such a genius. His memory, not so great, I guess. A little bit of a selective memory, that Dr. Fauci. Now, after that crazy COVID conspiracy theory turned out to be true, another one emerged. This being the crazy conspiracy theory that the COVID vaccines were neither totally safe nor particularly effective. This is when YouTube turns us off, by the way. So good night, everybody. Lovely to be with you. Hope you've enjoyed 4 minutes of my speech, but that's when they get you. So from the moment that the vaccines became available to the public, the established authorities all insisted that they were safe and totally effective. Biden, Fauci, Walensky, they all promised that the shots would prevent infection and transmission of the virus. Quote, "You're not going to get COVID if you have these vaccinations," Joe Biden. Fauci assured us, "When people are vaccinated, they can feel safe that they are not going to get infected." Rochelle Walensky insisted, "Vaccinated people do not," I don't do a good Walensky, so I'll just put that back in my regular voice. But Walensky insisted, "Vaccinated people do not carry the virus, do not get sick." On the one side, you had just about every single established authority in the country. On the other side, you had the crazy conspiracy theorists. Guess who was right? The conspiracy theorists, 100%. The established authorities, 0%. The authorities told us that the vaccines were totally safe. They told us that reports of vaccine injuries were a crazy conspiracy theory. Then people started coming down with blood clots and myocarditis and changes to women's menstrual cycles. That one, that last one, we were told by the public health propagandists was scientifically impossible. And then, I don't know, it just started happening. Then the so-called conspiracy theory turned out to be true, and according to recent studies, fairly widespread. Did you see just this week, just happened, I think yesterday, a writer in The Atlantic called for a pandemic amnesty. Did you see that? "Let's declare a pandemic amnesty," the author wrote. "We need to forgive one another for what we did and said when we were in the dark about COVID." Yeah. For over 2 years, the libs destroyed our economy, usurped our rights, kept our kids out of school, left our loved ones to die alone, forced us to inject ourselves with a dangerous and experimental drug or lose our jobs, and labeled us all conspiracy theorists to justify kicking us out of the public square when we rightly contradicted their false narrative. But that was then, and this is now, you see. That was back then when the libs had 100% of the power. Now, though, we're headed into the midterm elections. Republicans might get a tiny little bit of power. And so, you know, let's say we're even, okay? The conservatives were tormented. The libs did the tormenting. We all did stuff, okay? You know, and let's just forget about it, right? Right? I don't think so. Tribunals, actually, is what I'm responding to that offer with. You're offering amnesty. Okay, that's interesting. I'm hearing that. I am going to respond to that with military tribunals. That's my negotiating position. Let's see maybe where. How's that sound? Justice would be a good. I digress. We're already kicked off YouTube, so we can say whatever we want. We could go on about the vindication of COVID conspiracy theories all night. We have barely scratched the surface. And that is just COVID. Imagine that. That is just one part of one example from just the past few years. There are so many others. I've got one. How about this crazy conspiracy theory you may have heard of, that the Democrats rigged the 2020 election? Have you heard about that Looney Tune idea? The notion that the Democrats, you say, this is crazy, that the Democrats changed all of the election rules right before the election, in some cases illegally, to disadvantage Donald Trump and the Republicans and to give the Democrats an advantage. That, we were told, was completely insane. It's the delusions of tinfoil hat-clad lunatics, until the liberals themselves admitted that they had done it. They admitted it. On February 4th, 2021, Time Magazine published an account, a very detailed account, of the way that they rigged the election. It was called The Secret History of the Shadow Campaign That Saved the 2020 Election. Here's just a little sampling from that essay. In a way, Trump was right. There was a conspiracy unfolding behind the scenes, one that both curtailed the protests and coordinated the resistance from CEOs. Both surprises were the result of an informal alliance between left-wing activists and business titans. The handshake between business and labor was just one component of a vast cross-partisan campaign. Their work touched every aspect of the election. They got states to change voting systems and laws and helped secure hundreds of millions in public and private funding. They fended off voter suppression lawsuits. They recruited armies of poll workers. They got millions of people to vote by mail for the first time. They successfully pressured social media companies to take a harder line against disinformation and used data-driven strategies to fight viral smears. They executed national public awareness campaigns that helped Americans understand how the vote count would unfold over days and weeks. Just had to explain to Americans why we can't count our votes as quickly as Brazil does. You know, as quickly as tin pot dictatorships in Latin America. No, it's perfectly normal. It just takes days and weeks to count the votes because you understand the Democrats need to figure out how many votes they need. And then once they get that number, then it's very easy to find the ballots. It's right there in black and white, folks. This is not the ravings of a madman. This is not my own theory on how things work. This is the words of the liberals themselves, published in a very mainstream liberal outlet. Not so much a conspiracy theory as a confession of a conspiracy. Now, I suspect many people in this room could recite a litany of famous conspiracy theories that turned out to be true. I bet you could do it right off the top of your heads. This is a very famous one, the Tuskegee experiments. 1932, the U.S. Public Health Service conspired with the Tuskegee Institute to create a fake medical program. The program purported to treat syphilis, but instead it administered dangerous chemicals and procedures to roughly 400 black male participants. Only in the 1970s did the government cop to this conspiracy and pay out $10 million plus lifetime health benefits to the men that it had exploited. How about a slightly lesser known conspiracy? This one's fairly recent too, though. The Naira testimony. Do you remember that? Does anyone remember in the room the Naira testimony? A lot of people actually don't know about this one. The Naira testimony was 1990, a 15-year-old girl using the pseudonym Naira testified before Congress that after the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait, Iraqi soldiers had taken Kuwaiti babies out of incubators and left them to die on the hospital room floors and watched it and sort of mocked these babies as they died. This testimony was cited countless times by the Bush White House to justify American involvement in the Gulf War. Turned out the story was completely made up. And it wasn't just accidentally made up, it was made up by a PR firm that worked with the Bush White House. It was made up, very likely, in coordination with the White House itself. How about the gay frogs? You remember the gay frogs? That is 100% my favorite conspiracy theory that turned out to be true. When Alex Jones said on air, "They're turning the frickin' frogs gay," and then everybody made fun of him, and then he was totally right. Whatever Alex Jones has ever said in his life, it is simply a fact. They were turning the frickin' frogs gay. There was a team of scientists from Yale that analyzed 21 ponds in suburban Connecticut and found, actually, not only were they turning the frogs gay, they were turning them trans. Estrogenic waste in the water in these ponds was turning the frogs hermaphroditic. So not only was Alex Jones's crazy conspiracy theory true, it actually didn't go far enough. He was actually too modest in his commentary. Now, of course, any list of conspiracy theories turning out to be true is going to have to include a healthy dose of mentions of the CIA. The CIA would not be doing its job if it did not turn out on such a list. Some of these are famous, some of these are infamous, some of these you've never heard of. There is, of course, the usual fare of assassinating world leaders and covering that up. That has been well documented. But there are certain CIA conspiracies that took place on American soil itself. A very well-known one would be MK Ultra, which is extremely weird. Coincidentally, also my nickname. I think that's a good nickname, MK Ultra. So I think I'm going to try to make that happen. The MK Ultra conspiracy was the conspiracy of the CIA to ply unwitting Americans and Canadians with LSD, and then to pay off hospitals and prisons and universities to keep quiet about it. That conspiracy was not discovered until 1975. That was 2 years after CIA Director Richard Helms ordered that all the documents pertaining to MKUltra be destroyed, though a 1977 Freedom of Information Act request did uncover some 20,000 remaining documents to aid in the work of the Church Committee and the President's Commission on CIA Activities in the U.S. Then there's Operation Mockingbird. That one, again, very basic. It was the very effective CIA campaign to control the messaging coming out of the New York Times and Newsweek and CBS and lots of other news outlets. This is run-of-the-mill stuff. I don't think, does anyone in this room believe the New York Times is a serious journalistic outlet? I don't think so. Frankly, I wish they were spending more time on CIA propaganda. Some of the stuff that they run is much worse than that. Some of it was less run-of-the-mill, though. Conspiracies such as Operation Northwoods, a 1962 CIA proposal to launch a false flag attack on American military and civilian targets and then blame it on Fidel Castro and then channel that outrage to launch a war against Cuba. That particular conspiracy, thankfully, never went into effect because the Kennedy administration rejected it. But the top secret document outlining the proposal has been declassified. It was declassified in 1997. It's available in plain English for anyone to read. It sounds completely insane, but you can look it up. You can read the actual document. Operation Northwoods is about as crazy a conspiracy theory as one could possibly think up. And yet, it happens to be true. Putting the CIA aside for a moment, we learned just yesterday about a new sort of Operation Mockingbird, this time coming out of the Department of Homeland Security. It's happening right now. According to reporting from The Intercept, in the lead up to the 2020 election, big tech companies, including not just Twitter and Facebook, but Reddit, Discord, Wikipedia, Microsoft, LinkedIn, and a number of others, met on a monthly basis with the FBI, with the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, and with other government representatives. These meetings did not just concern technology, hacking, that sort of thing. The meetings concerned disinformation. And by disinformation, I of course mean information that was harmful to Democrats. Twitter and Facebook had direct portals for the government to request that inconvenient information be censored, direct portals they could go to. According to documents filed in federal court in a lawsuit brought by the attorneys general of Missouri and Louisiana, two FBI agents, Elvis Chan and Laura Demlow, were involved in high-level communication with tech executives that, quote, led to Facebook's suppression of the Hunter Biden laptop story. The Hunter Biden laptop story, which was suppressed by all the big tech platforms, which according to post-election polls, single-handedly could have swung the election to Trump. Why was that story stopped? Because of phone calls from the FBI. It was a conspiracy, plain and simple. So if you observe historical facts, does that make you a conspiracy theorist? I guess it does. You are putting forward a theory about a conspiracy. But in the case of all the examples that I just cited, and countless others on top of that, you would be theorizing about conspiracies that indisputably occurred. When a conspiracy theory is demonstrably true, who could deny it? Only a fool, or a liar, or a coward. And I think it's that latter category there that explains and describes most people in whom the phrase conspiracy theory still inspires fear and dread. The sort of people who knew from the beginning that the official story on COVID's origins didn't really make a lot of sense. The people who suspected that the vaccines were probably not quite as safe and effective as we were told. The people who sense intuitively that there were some serious structural shenanigans in the 2020 elections. Widespread mail-in ballots in contravention of the Pennsylvania State Constitution, to cite just one example. People who suspect all of those things, but don't dare raise the suggestion because they fear for their social media accounts, or for their jobs, or just their social standing, which depends upon going along to get along and denying what one can see with one's own eyes. People who understand that the true function of the label conspiracy theorist is not to separate truth from fantasy, but rather simply to get dissidents to shut up. When did this fear of conspiracy theorizing begin? Not all that long ago, it turns out. A Google Ngram analysis reveals that the term conspiracy theory appeared basically nowhere in the English language until the mid-1930s, and it only really took off after 1950. The term conspiracy theorist is of an even more recent vintage, appearing basically nowhere until the mid-60s, not really taking off until 1990. I mentioned earlier that the term conspiracy theorist fulfills a similar function to the word racist. That is, it's an accusation that when successfully applied, completely destroys a man's reputation in the public square. It's a label that means little more than this person is bad and or stupid and you should not take him seriously. The word racist follows almost exactly the same historical pattern of usage. Racism and racist appeared pretty much nowhere until the mid-30s. They became popular only after 1950. In other words, these two terms of abuse, these linguistic weapons, only came into fashion during the era of the post-war liberal consensus. And during that entire time, they have been used almost exclusively to attack conservatives. Liberals have a much worse record on race than conservatives do, a much more perverse view of race. Doesn't matter. The stench of racism only ever sticks to conservatives. But Joe Biden says that Barack Obama is the first clean, articulate black man in American politics. Doesn't matter. The Democrat Party founds and runs the KKK for the entirety of its existence as an organization. Doesn't matter. But if a conservative criticizes George Soros, the most prominent and prolific funder of far-left causes in the world, that conservative will instantly be labeled an anti-Semite. A conspiracy theorist too, actually. If a conservative criticizes Barack Obama, he will instantly be labeled a racist. And the same goes for conspiracy theories. Think of the absurd narratives that the mainstream liberal establishment has tried to sell us in recent years. It's amazing to think back and remember that this actually happened. They told us for years on end that Donald Trump, the man that we've all known since, what, the 80s or earlier, Donald, the guy in Home Alone, you know, the guy that saved the ice rink in New York, Donald Trump was secretly a Russian asset, some kind of sleeper KGB agent who was going to do Putin's bidding because Putin had a videotape of him urinating on prostitutes in Moscow. It wasn't crazy radical, well, they were crazy and radical, but it was the mainstream liberals who told us this for years on all the mainstream news outlets. Never mind that Donald Trump has been the most hardline president on Russia in my lifetime. Never mind that Donald Trump is the only president since Vladimir Putin's rise to power on whose watch Vladimir Putin did not invade a sovereign nation. It's kind of weird, isn't it? George W. Bush, Putin invades Georgia. Barack Obama, Putin invades Ukraine. Donald Trump, we just kind of chill, you know? And then Joe Biden, Putin goes even further into Ukraine. Never mind that these guys could not produce a single shred of evidence for their insane conspiracy theory. They just peddled it for years and years, and then when it completely fell apart during the Mueller investigation, they just moved on as if nothing had happened. They're going to call for amnesty. They're going to call for a truce. Never mind. Never mind that we undermine the administration. Move on. Never mind. Yet the left still has the audacity to accuse the right, increasingly, of embracing conspiracy theories. Perhaps we are. But if there is a rise in conspiracy theorizing on the right, it is not due to any defect in the rational faculties of conservatives. It is due to a rise in actual conspiracies on the left. Conspiracy theories flourish when people lose trust in their political institutions, as we are seeing today. But the collapsing credibility of our institutions is not the fault of conservatives. It is the fault of the liberals who have controlled those institutions for decades and run them into the ground. To be a conspiracy theorist during times of political order and transparency is kooky and ridiculous. But to be a conspiracy theorist during times of profuse conspiracy is rational and prudent. In an age such as ours, the difference between a conspiracy theory and the truth is often not the difference between delusion and reality. As our liberal ruling class has shown so clearly over the past few years, in an age such as ours, the real difference between a conspiracy theory and the truth is about 3 to 6 months. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Now, we have time for questions, and we have this stupid rule at the Daily Wire, which I hate, which is that if you disagree with me, you get to cut all those good people in line, all those good conservatives, you get to come to the front of the line. I hate this. If you disagree with me, I want to ship you off to Guantanamo Bay, but the rules are the rules, and so we will abide by them.
Thank you so much for coming out tonight, Mr. Knowles. We appreciate it. He will be taking your questions now, so if you have one, if you could go around back to our colleague with the white shirt, and then you can come up to this tape right here. Try to keep your questions brief, and I'll hold the microphone. And with that, we can take the first question.
Hi, Mr. Knowles, big fan. So I'm a senior in high school, and I'm working on college applications right now, and I was wondering, how much should political and religious affiliations have to do with your decision process?
Of where to go to college or how to write your essay? It depends what you want out of education. The liberals have imposed on us this one-size-fits-all education program, which is that everyone needs to go to some liberal university and do a bunch of drugs and have sex with a bunch of people and get indoctrinated by communists and then go out and destroy the country. And they want everyone to do it, and they're going to pay for it, probably, if Joe Biden has his way. But you have to ask yourself, as with any endeavor in life, what do I want out of this? If you want a classically liberal education, liberal in the good sense of the word, then you should go study history at some good liberal arts university. Or liberal arts college. If you want a technical education, if you want to learn how to be an accountant and get a stable job, then you can go get that sort of a technical education. If you want to become a welder, then you should go maybe pursue an apprenticeship or a trade school, and you will get that kind of an education. And if you think that college is a big waste of money and you've got a good job lined up and it doesn't require any sort of particular humanities education or like that, then go do that, make a bunch of money, and make fun of all your friends who are hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. But as with any activity in life, you have to ask what the end goal is. And for a lot of students, the end goal of college is to go have a good time and take a four-year vacation from life and get up to all sorts of trouble. And I speak with a little bit of experience in this regard, and I can tell you there are much more edifying ways to spend that time. And so I would just think very clearly about it. And by the way, if you want to go be an investment banker and go run the world at Davos or something, then by all means go to Harvard, and that will actually help you to do that. But I can't answer that question for you, for what you want out of college. And I think that You ask what should your family views be about that? What should the family influence be on this? They're probably going to pay the bill, so they should probably have some say over it. And you ask what the religious view on this is, and that should inform every single decision you make in life, because that's the sort of bedrock foundation of your way of viewing yourself in the world. So the only thing I would tell you not to do is what the liberals want you to do and go do a bunch of drugs and become a communist. Other than that, though, I trust your judgment to make the right choice.
Thank you.
Hey, Michael, big fan. I'm also a high schooler like this young lady. I kind of wanted to ask, you probably get this type of question a lot, but I'm currently in U.S. history and I've got a pretty radical teacher, but things like we're covering like Civil War right now, colonization, and a lot of my other classmates are also, you know, very radical thinkers. How would you go about, combating some of those ideas and, you know, like a way that creates conversation and not just creates like arguments?
You are not in the class to own the libs with facts and logic. That can be your hobby outside of class. That could be your calling in life, but that is not your purpose in the class. Your purpose in the class is to learn whatever you can. It sounds like you've got a teacher who's not going to teach you very much, but listen, every man is my master and I can learn from him. So you can learn something, at least from being exposed to these ideas and learning how to combat them for your own edification. I would not encourage you to hide your views. I think that's a bad idea, and it's going to teach you to cultivate the vice of cowardice, and courage is not only a virtue, but the prerequisite for all of the other virtues, and you're going to live a bad life if you live like a little weakling, you know, and try to pretend to be somebody that you're not and effectively lie about what you think. On the other hand, you don't need to be flamboyant. You don't need to wear the MAGA hat to class every single day, you know, maybe make that a twice a week sort of thing, and you don't need to be shouting your political allegiances from the rooftops. A very effective way to debate in the context that you're describing, which is more intimate, personal, in a classroom with a small group of friends, is just by asking questions. If it was good enough for Socrates, it will be good enough for you. And you will either hear the very best arguments for the radical side in response to these questions, or you will watch the arguments unravel in real time. And one will be edifying and one will be hilarious. And either way, I think that you will be amused by it. And it's also very disarming. So I would just ask those questions. And then once you leave the classroom and you're in the public square, you can take what you have learned and use that to accomplish what I suspect is your ultimate goal in studying history, which is, of course, to own the libs with both facts and logic.
Hello, big fan. I had a friend who told me to, I don't know how if this is going to be okay, but he told me to F off because I didn't support his sex change. I still wanted to be friends. From this relationship, something I noticed as a Christian is that this trans ideology comes along during the same identity crisis that you see before someone would begin to look for a higher belonging, usually fulfilled in like Christianity or religion. Something I've also noticed in several arguments with that guy was that no matter the logic, his emotions just overcame the facts that came out that he didn't want to be true. So I was wondering if you could weigh in on that and if that's something you've noticed, like as a Catholic.
Of course. Of course it is. And I'm not surprised that you get a little choked up talking about it, because it's a very traumatic and terrible thing that people who have fallen sway to not just a mental illness, but a real social contagion and a very pernicious ideology that's being pushed by the principalities and powers of this world and the wickedness in high places, spiritually and politically. It's a very, very difficult thing to see that at work in someone. You're totally right to point out that the mode in which he is going through his transition bears some resemblance to the mode in which someone might convert to a religion or to true religion, you know, to Christianity. But both of those issues concern identity. Who am I? And when you ground your answer to that in the answer that God gives to Adam at the burning bush when Adam says, when Moses says, "Who are you?" And God says, "I am who I am." When you ground your identity in "I am," you know, Christ says before Abraham was, "I am." When you ground your identity in him, then you know who you are. And when you reject him and you reject that understanding of human nature and reality, you're only going to be confused, and you see this taken to its extraordinarily illogical conclusion in something like transgenderism, which is just a moving target of identity that will ultimately not be fulfilling because it's absurd. And so I would approach that from a position of pity and compassion. But you can't make him be friends with you, and you can't make him see the truth. He's demanding that you accede to his absurd anthropology because he suspects deep down that it isn't true, and that's why if he were confident in his view of human nature and the world, if these people were confident in that, they wouldn't demand that we affirm every delusion that they've ever had constantly in every single social setting. They know that it's not true, and they're just hoping that by the very power of their speech, they can recreate the world and fashion it after their own fantasies. But that's not going to happen, and so all you can do is speak the truth with love to your friend. And maybe he'll come around and maybe he won't. Ultimately, that is not up to you, because unlike the transgenderists and the radical leftists, we don't think that we ultimately control the world. So someone bigger and more important than us controls the world.
Yeah. Hey, how's it going, Michael? Good talk today. My name is actually Michael, too. So
great name.
Yeah.
Great name.
For sure.
I can tell
sure.
You're wise already.
Yeah. So I came to the front because I think rather than a disagreement, we have more of a difference of perspective. So when you were talking about the conspiracy theories, you know, all of the examples that you gave, whether it was Mockingbird or MK Ultra or Tuskegee, just to me, all of these seemed like all of these and even others, which I would say are true. These seemed more like it was examples of the government and people in power, lying to the general population, as my friend said, you know, effing all of us over. So not so much the left versus the right. So I'm just curious, do you think that it would be more effective to talk about these conspiracies from the past and from the present in ways that are less divisive? I can't help but think that if we tried to do it in this way, rather than, you know, the stupid libs and the hateful conservatives, that we could potentially come together as a people and help each other see the truth and instead of you know, half and half being blinded by hatred.
Sure. Well, the point that you bring up that I think is most important is seeing the truth. And so when I frame these discussions as a left versus right or a conservatives versus the libs sort of angle, I'm not disagreeing with your framing of the people broadly versus the people in power, the less powerful people versus the more powerful people. I'm just going further to observe a fact that for the past 50, 60 years, and really probably even a little longer than that, the people in power are almost uniformly liberals. I'm not talking about which party controls the Congress, which increasingly doesn't even really matter all that much. I'm talking about which ideological group of people controls the media. That would be the libs. Who controls the universities? That would be the libs. Who controls the big corporations? That's the libs. They kind of pretend it's the conservatives, but it's not. I think we've seen that pretty clearly over the last few years. Who controls the bureaucracy? The libs. Who controls the foreign policy? It's the libs. So when I say it's the libs, I'm saying that because I don't merely want to shake my fist at some crusty old man wearing a suit with a monocle, you know, in some high position of power. I want to look at it from the ideas that are motivating them and the intellectual and political context in which they find themselves. And it happens to be the case that it is the liberal establishment that has been perpetrating these conspiracies, call them what they are. The liberals admit it themselves, like in that Time magazine article. They are the ones who have been perpetrating these conspiracies on people. And so the people on whom the conspiracies have been perpetrated might not all self-identify as conservatives. I suspect actually the majority of them do not. But that is the real distinction here. And I think The people who view this as merely a game of the red party versus the blue party trying to fight over elections, they're missing the way that power actually works in the United States. The U.S. government simply does not work like the bill up on Capitol Hill that we all learned about in Schoolhouse Rock. I don't remember, you know, the United States Department of Homeland Security factoring in anywhere in the bill up on Capitol Hill. I don't remember the media or the universities or the State Department or anything else factoring in there. So power is just exercised in a different way. And on the happy occasions that Republicans win one house of Congress or something, it's good, it does something, but we have to recognize the stakes of the political battle we're up against. Because even if we win every single election and we have the Supreme Court, we are still at a major disadvantage in terms of the actual exercise of power in this country. And so in summation, I do think we still have to own the libs, you know, and we shouldn't do it in a hateful way or to be cruel to anybody, but we have to call out the ideas that are animating these sides because the ideas have drastic consequences.
Yeah, I think you made a really good point. I'm curious, just sort of thinking about what you said earlier, if you think, you know, all the way back to the 1930s, you said was when I guess we could say that the liberal establishment sort of took a stronghold in the country. It's pretty, I guess, disheartening for some people to think that that's where the balance of power has been for almost a century now.
Yeah.
So from your perspective, what do you see as, I know this is pretty high level, I guess, broad, but what do you see as the ideal way forward for America if we want to move towards truth?
Gradually and then suddenly. I think that the liberals did not win their power overnight. They won it over many decades of steadily chipping away and transforming the country. And so I'm not despairing in any way. I'm not black-pilled on the situation to sound like a cool zoomer, okay? I have a great deal of hope, and I have hope because hope is not just a happy feeling, but it's a theological fact and virtue as far as I'm concerned, and it's a demand that we have hope. So I think that we could do it. I think political orders have been overturned many times before. As Cardinal Manning observes, to give us all a lot of hope, there is a day to come that will reverse the confident judgments of men, and all the smart, powerful people with the lab coats and the fancy ties on all the TV networks who believe that they're going to be in power forever, that's not going to happen. That's not how regimes work. And you saw this on one particular issue, on the pro-life issue, one of the few where conservatives didn't just completely abandon our principles at the first sign of trouble, and the pro-lifers held firm. It didn't even take 50 years. It took 49 years to reverse Roe v. Wade. The country has all of the momentum now on the side of pro-life. And so if there are lessons to learn from that, one, it shows that contrary to the liberal sort of establishment stooges who pretended that we had to give up on all of the cultural issues are winning issues. They're a hell of a lot more important than marginal tax rates, much as I like to pay low taxes. And so that's a lesson for, I think, ordinary run-of-the-mill conservatives to learn. I think that gains are not going to be made in one or two election cycles. They're going to be made generationally. Sometimes it's going to take two generations. It's okay. Patience is a virtue, too. And it shows you that when we get down and we fight in the same kind of language, the moral language that the left uses to, the left uses it to unjust ends, we can use it to just ends, that we can win. If you look on any of the big issues that we're all fighting over right now, you know, we're all fighting over transgenderism because the left is just fanatically obsessed with this issue of allowing men to go into the girls' room. If you did a poll, there have been polls of the American people broadly on this issue, 80% of Americans are with us. They don't think that men can secretly be women. They don't think boys should be putting on leotards and swimming on the girls' swimming team and taking the trophies away from the little girls. They're totally with us on this. You look on abortion, Americans are overwhelmingly pro-life when you get into the nitty-gritty of the questions. You look on immigration, the vast majority of Americans want to drastically reduce all immigration, not just illegal immigration, but legal immigration as well. That's according to a Harvard-Harris poll not so long ago. And yet, the ruling establishment, the Democrat Party, but also a lot of people in the Republican Party, they ignore that. And they ignore that to their own peril, because eventually the truth comes out and the people will not be bullied around forever and ever. There will be a day to come that will reverse the confident judgments of men. And in that, I think we can have a great deal of hope, and we have to have the courage to
bring that day around sooner rather than later.
Good evening, Mr. Knowles. So I'm currently in high school, like a couple of the other people that have come up. And looking back in middle school, a lot of my friend group leaned a lot more conservative, a lot of them were religious Catholics. And one of my best friends, Sam, I give him a shout out right now, he is the one that kind of prompted me to move into the conservative side of politics. But looking at my current friend group, there's not as many of those that are as religious or as conservative. And I don't know how to quite approach that, if I should avoid politics with them, if I should look for a new friend group, if I, like, what's your advice for somebody in my position at my age?
You're already ahead of the game. I was never really a lib, but I was an atheist when I was your age, so you're clearly far ahead of the game. You will naturally gravitate toward people who view the world in a similar way to the way that you view it. One of the biggest lies that we're told right now is that diversity is the greatest of all possible virtues, and it's not. Unity is. We're not called the diverse states of America. You don't pay $250,000 to go to diversity, you know, to the diversity of Kentucky, right? You're gonna go to the university. We are the United States of America, out of many one. So we have diverse backgrounds necessarily. We're all different people. But a true friend is not someone with whom you don't agree on anything. I mean, that you can't really, not only can you not be friends with someone with whom you don't share anything in common, you can't even speak to that person. You won't even speak the same language. A true friend is someone who is sort of on the same journey as you, who's standing next to you looking at the same thing, perhaps from that slightly different angle, but it is in that unity that you're going to find a much more fruitful friendship, the real deep meaning of friendship, not just the kind of frivolous go around and watch the football game way that our culture has degraded friendship in its ongoing war on men. So I just think you don't really need to worry about it. It will happen. You will grow together or you will grow apart with your friends, and especially one day with your spouse. And as that process plays out, I don't think you need to hasten it along. I don't think you need to tell your friends to go pound sand because, you know, they don't like Trump or something. That will happen naturally because you're still very young and you've got a head start because you know things that many of your friends do not know. And you can have plenty of grace for them for being a little bit ignorant on these topics. And maybe you can try to bring them along, but eventually your friend group might look a little bit different in 5 years than it does today.
Mr. Knowles, thanks for coming to Little Old Lexington. We appreciate it. My question's short. Another round of elections coming up. Do you expect any 2020 style chicanery or violence this time around?
Yes. I might not have answered that way, but for 2 hours ago, while I was driving here to Kentucky, I saw something new pop up on my Twitter, and it said, Don't forget that the election results are not going to come in on election night. Don't forget it's going to take days. And the candidates who look like they might be winning on election night, they might not actually be the winning candidates. And I thought, here we freaking go again. Here we go. Brazil can conduct an election. Argentina can conduct an election. I don't know, but America, first of all, we can't conduct an election. We got the results of the Brazilian election same night, last night. And the conservative lost and the conservative conceded. Here, we can't do that. We can't do that. They don't have the COVID excuse this time. Last time they used COVID as a reason to extend Election Day into election season and to send out all the widespread mail-ins and to dig up a bunch of corpses to go vote for the other corpse who was the nominee of the Democrat Party that year. And so they don't have that same excuse this time, but of course they're going to try it. You know that they're going to try it because they've got absolutely nothing in the election. The polls are all devastating for them. That this president and vice president are the least popular president and vice president we've ever seen at this point in an administration. If you look at every single issue, they're losing on every single one, including COVID. That was the one issue that they had been above water on. They're now losing on that issue. So the only hope they have to retain any power is for a couple water mains to burst in Georgia, you know, on election night. And there are going to be some key races where they try to do it. They're going to try to do it in Georgia. They're going to try to do it in Pennsylvania. I think they're probably going to try to do it in Arizona. Now, because they did it last time, there is the old fool me once, shame on you. And then to quote George W. Bush, fool me twice. The point is that you're not going to fool me again. So
You know, it would be very difficult for them to do that persuasively, but are they going to try? Yes, of course, they're already doing it.
Hi, Mr. Knowles. I had a previous question I was going to ask you, but I changed my mind just before. I was wondering, you mentioned that liberals often call us anti-Semites, and I was wondering, I have a lot of Jewish friends, and I know that a lot of Jewish people are leaning towards conservative, and I was wondering, how do liberals spin that we're anti-Semitic when, like, they have major leaders who are just outward anti-Semitics, pro-Palestine, anti-Jewish, and all this? How do they spin this in their heads and out into the world?
Because that term, anti-Semite, just like racist, just like conspiracy theorist, is not a neutral term to be bandied about for the objective pursuit of truth. It is just a term to attack conservatives. So Ilhan Omar says, I pray that Allah awaken the world to the crimes of Israel, and that doesn't matter. That just kind of goes away. But Barack Obama takes smiling pictures with Louis Farrakhan, who says the worst things about the Jews that you can possibly imagine. It doesn't matter. None of that matters. It rises to the level of a national conversation through the establishment media if it can be used to attack the conservatives. And so they're going to use it that way. If they can find one right-winger who says anything even slightly negative about George Soros or something, you know, for some completely different reason, totally divorced from his religious views, they're going to do that, and which is why we can't take it seriously. The reason not to take these words seriously is not because we shouldn't care about racial issues or the difference between delusion and reality or the Jews or anything like that. But the reason not to take these words seriously is because they're not used in good faith. They don't mean what the people using them say that they mean. And it's just a cudgel, and we're just, you know, we're Charlie Brown with the football. If we think that we're finally going to hit the football this time, guys, we're going to convince them that we're not racist or anti-Semitic or conspiracy theorists or whatever. No, that's the premise that the libs are beginning with. So you're not going to convince them of that. There's no argument that's going to work on them, because that's where they're starting from. So the best we can do is live our lives and, through our example, I think, show that these accusations are preposterous. Yeah.
Just like to thank you, first of all, for coming out. To go back to your speech in terms of conspiracy theories, as a person who, I guess, believes in these conspiracy theories, like the concept that there are two biological genders.
Oh, here we go. We got Mr. Tinfoil Hat over here. All right.
How do we go into these election cycles, and as someone who's a first-time voter, stand up for these, I guess, crazy views and make sure that we're voting for candidates that stand for these same things?
The primary process is where you really should do it. I hope that Dr. Oz wins the race, because John Fetterman is not only is he not a functioning at the moment because he has brain damage, but he also, even before that, he just has insane views. He would have been a rubber stamp for Chuck Schumer, and so it would be very bad. And if the Senate majority hinges on him, it would be better, I think, for the Republicans to control the Senate majority. But Dr. Oz, it drives me crazy because he's a liberal. You know, he's to the left of Barack Obama running in 2008, and that drives me up a wall. And so in the primary, I was pretty vocal against Dr. Oz, and I just think it's insane that we'll have a Republican so-called conservative candidate who doesn't know what marriage is and who doesn't stand, and who was mocking and insulting pro-lifers not all that long ago on the radio. And so it drives me completely insane. And then we lost that primary, and so now I think it's imperative to support a Republican majority. I think that will overall be better for the country, and if Dr. Oz is part of that, okay, that's what we have to do. But that's where the primary process really matters. And a lot of people don't pay attention to the primaries, and a lot of the big money comes in and tries to get rid of the real conservative candidates, because the established people who have a huge sway over primaries are not conservative in almost any case. So that's where you've really, really got to focus on that. And then you, when you're persuading your fellow citizens, you have to not care when they call you all the terrible names in the book. When I was a kid, I was the golden boy of my community, class president every year, student body president of the school, every parent's favorite little boy to bring home to dinner, okay? And then I committed a terrible transgression. I worked on a Republican campaign for Congress in my area, an extremely mainstream Republican campaign, that, and I committed a further transgression, which is that our campaign won, and instantly, overnight, half the people who previously said I was the most wonderful boy in the world said that I was the absolute devil, the incarnation of evil. And that's just what happens. You know, that's what you sign up for when you get into politics. And so I think it's to a purpose. I mean, you look at other great men in history, like, you know, Socrates, they weren't so nice to him. Our Lord and Savior, you know, they weren't particularly nice to him when he was incarnate on this earth. And so you can expect that. We were told to expect that. And if you can't take it, then don't be involved in politics. But you really should take it, because we're called on to have courage and integrity to stand up for truth. And if you're not willing to do that, what are you living for? So that you can watch more British Bake Off on your couch and eat some crackers while the world burns? Okay, doesn't seem like a fulfilling life to me. So stand up and take it, all right?
All right. This next question will be our final question.
No, no, that's terrible. All right, this better be a great question.
That's a lot of pressure. So, in the words of some press secretary, I'm going to circle back to censorship. Which, shout out to Steven Crowder, who just got banned on YouTube.
Did he?
Yeah, for
Again?
2 weeks, right before the midterms.
That guy's been banned like 100 times on YouTube.
I know. He's still on Rumble, though. So.
By the way, if anyone can come back and beat the algorithms, it is Steven Crowder. I've watched that man be waterboarded for like 25 minutes or something. He's a complete maniac, but he's very, very durable. So I hope he'll be back.
It's the Canadian in him.
Is that it?
Anyway.
So used to abuse. You know, you just take it.
So, moving on, do you believe that governmental agencies such as the CDC and DHS infringed on the First Amendment by requesting social media censorship, which recently the social media leadership teams have actually admitted to complying with? And if so, what do you think should be done about it?
Sure, that's one way of looking at it. I mean, I look at it kind of more from the other angle, which is that these allegedly private companies, Twitter, Facebook, Google, are themselves infringing our First Amendment rights because they are not actually private actors. They are working as an arm of the government. And we now know this because they were meeting with the government once a month and they were taking down specific stories when the government pressured them to do that. And so I think we need to hold them accountable. I think it'll be much easier to hold them accountable. And for years, we had these absolute jokers on the right say that, well, if you don't like Twitter censoring you, or Twitter's even a small part of the problem. If you don't like Google or Facebook censoring you, well, just build your own Google. You know, just build your own largest corporation ever that was built in concert with the U.S. government and which has more power than almost any entity in the history of the world. Just do that, right? No, I don't think so. I think I'd rather use my political power on the happy occasions that I have it to bring those institutions into compliance with our traditional American order. Because if my rights and way of life are taken away from me by Google, I'm not going to say, oh, you know, I've got the boot on my neck. I say, oh, well, actually, it's totally fine because it's a private corporation destroying my life. No, I don't. Thank goodness it isn't the government. No, I actually just don't want my way of life being taken from me. I don't want my rights being taken from me. And I want to use every single political means at my disposal to bring the bad fellows who are doing it into line because this distinction between, you know, the politics and the culture or the government and the private sector, it just kind of breaks down when we're talking about the allegedly private corporations that meet regularly with the feds who control the entire public square, which in a republic means they control the whole political order because the way we supposedly govern ourselves is by speaking to our fellow citizens and getting the word out there and persuading one another and passing laws. That's the way it's supposed to work. It's the way it did work for a long time in this country. And we better do everything in our political power to bring it back again, because if we don't, we've already lost the game. I think we can do it. I think the momentum is behind us. I think the libs are on the run. I think they feel their grip on power is weakening, and I think we just got to keep pushing. Keep on pushing harder and harder. We are almost there. Do not lose hope. We are very, very close. We can, and I think we will, make America great again. Thank you very much for the question. Thank you very much to all of you for having me here at the University of Kentucky. It's wonderful. Thank you very much. Very, very kind of you. All right. Thank you so much. Can't wait to be back in Kentucky.
I can't wait to grab a bourbon on my way back out of this state. Have a good night. Thank you.